Welcome to the eAcademy. This is the next episode in which we focus on the interaction of the PERFECTA 64M control panel with ABAX 2 wireless devices. The last time, we added two wireless detectors to the system and discussed how to reserve addresses and groups in the zone list. Now we move on to the next issues. To begin with, it is worth pointing out that the data of the ABAX 2 wireless devices which we add to our system is stored in the ACU controller. So, if it happens that a controller with previously registered devices is connected to a control panel, these will be added to the system. Therefore, it is important to bear in mind that, depending on the situation, this will affect our work. On the one hand, it may be improved if we purposely add a controller with devices already registered. On the other hand, complications such as address conflicts or unexpected tamper alarms may arise. The ABAX 2 controllers can support a maximum of 48 detectors, sirens, controllers, etc. And here the key word is maximum. Why? This is because not all devices occupy just one position each in the controller. Some of them can take up more positions automatically, or we will be able to determine the number ourselves. And so, in the case of expansion modules of wired zones and outputs, such as the ACX220 model, which is equipped with four programmable zones, as many as four zones must be reserved in the control panel. Consequently, after registering such a module in the controller, the number of positions for further devices will be reduced by exactly four. As a result, if a set of 48 positions was available before it was registered, 44 positions will remain free after it is added to the system. An important point here, for keypads and remote key fobs, separate sets of positions are reserved. So the rules just discussed do not apply to them. As I mentioned in the previous episode, you can assign detectors, sirens and other wireless devices to zones numbered 9 to 56. And as I showed you in the previous episode, when adding a device, you can select the zone number to which the device will be allocated. So, what if a device occupies more than one position in the device list? That is, more than one zone. Well, the additional zones will be allocated automatically. Of course, these will be the ones following the one just selected. In the case of devices such as the ACX220 expander mentioned before, in addition to being allocated to four zones, it is also associated with four outputs, and their numbers are assigned automatically. For zones 9 to 16, these are outputs with numbers from 5 to 12. For zones from 17 to 56, the output number is the same as the selected zone number. Okay. Now let's move on to the settings of our wireless module. We will now add the AXD200 multipurpose detector to the system. The eAcademy's video database includes episode 61, which was dedicated entirely to this device. However, it should be added that several key changes have been made since we shot that video. The first is the increase in the number of modes in which this device can operate. Previously, seven modes were available in which the AXD200 could operate as magnetic contact, dual channel magnetic contact with roller shutter input, shock detector and magnetic contact, reorientation detector, temperature detector or water flood detector. Their operation was presented in detail in the archival episode mentioned before. There are now two more modes in which the AXD200 can operate as a wide zone expander. In the first case, it supports two NC zones, so you can connect, for example, two magnetic contacts. In the second one, a magnetic contact and a detector of roller shutter type. The second major difference regarding the AXD200 is how its mode of operation is selected. Originally, it was necessary to hit its enclosure in the right way. For devices with up-to-date software, we can do this in a simpler way. I go over to PERFECTA Soft. I select the Hardware tab and the Wireless module. Now we'll add AXD200 to the system. To do this, I click the plus button and I enter the serial number of the device. We will add our detector in the first available position. So we specify zone number 9. I put the battery into the detector. According to the instructions, we trigger the device tamper contact. Okay, the device data has been loaded. The detector will resume the mode in which it was operating. However, let's expand the list. As I said before, there are currently 9 modes available. Now, depending on which mode you choose, there will be an option to specify how many positions you want the device to occupy. So for example, for a detector in the flood mode, namely AFD 200, only one position will be used. And for AMD 201, we can already make a choice whether to use only one or two positions. We can also see that below in the zone number field, one or two consecutive zone numbers respectively are visible. I choose two positions zones, number 9 and 10. Approved. I send data to the controller. I approve the identification of modules and read data from the control panel. Now I'll go to the Zones tab. As you can see, the detector has taken 2 independent zones, and each of them can be configured in a slightly different way. Okay, let's go now to wireless devices of a different type. Wireless keypads and remote key fobs are not included in this set of 48 devices added to the controller. They are supported independently. In the case of keypads, we can add up to 4 of them to the system. Of course, this number will be smaller if there are wired keypads already connected to the control panel, as is the case of our system. So let's take a look at the appropriate tab in the program. We can see that addresses 0 and 2 are already taken up by wired models. So we select one of the grayed out tiles described as keypad. A plus button can be seen at the bottom of the window. We click. Let's enter the serial number of the device. Batteries were placed in the keypad beforehand, so I press any button. Again. Okay, the device has been read properly. Approved. Here it is worth adding that the PERFECTA2 model is fitted with a 125 kHz proximity card reader. So before saving the data, I check the appropriate option to keep the reader on. Right away, I'll show you how to allocate a proximity card to a selected system user. I go to the Users tab. Next to the table, you can see a plus button, so I click it. At the moment, I have only one reader in the system. I also specify the user I want to allocate the card to. I press any button and wait for the keypad to wake up. I put the card at the keyboard level. Again. Okay, the card has been read and I can save it. Here you can specify how to control the system's armed mode, whether by bringing the card read only or by holding it down. If only reading the card is marked, the selected controllable outputs can also be switched on off by holding down the card. I will save the data. Let's see how arming the system using the card works in practice. First, I wake up the keypad. Next, the application of the card. As you can see, the exit delay time countdown has started, and the system has armed. To turn this off, I apply the card again. Okay, the countdown has been interrupted. The system is disarmed. By the way, it is worth mentioning that the wireless keypads have a built-in connector through which a 5 VDC power supply can be connected, for example from the APS055 flush-mounted power supply. When connected in this way, the 2 CR123A batteries installed in the keypad will only provide backup power in the event of a mains power failure. Alright, let's return to the Users tab. The PERFECTA 64M control panel can be used with as many remote controls as the number of users, that is, a maximum of 62. As an example, we will add one remote key fob to the system. I click the plus button below the Users table and enter the serial number of the key fob. I press any button. Okay, the key fob data has been read. I check the user number again. Okay. Now, by right-clicking on the fields associated with individual buttons on the remote key fob, we can select which function is to be activated. Next to it, in the Event column, We can mark whether the use of the remote key fob is to be stored in the event memory or not. And in the color-coded columns, which represent the LEDs of the key fob, we can specify how the LEDs will behave when any button is pressed. I right-click on one of the fields. Now you can set whether the LED should light up or be switched off. But the most interesting option is the possibility of setting a particular LED to indicate the status of one of the control panel outputs after pressing a remote key fob button. The output number can be simply entered manually too. In this way, LEDs can be used to provide confirmation of, for example, switching on a light or alarming a selected partition. To test this in practice, we specify that the red LED should be on every time, and the yellow and green will correspond to the status of outputs 5 and 6, respectively. In addition, the button with an empty circle will change the status of output 5, while the one with a full circle will change the status of output 6. In the meantime, both outputs types have been set as controlled. Let's save the data in the control panel. To begin with, you press a button to which no function has been allocated. Okay, the red LED lit up, while the yellow and green LEDs didn't. That is, the outputs are off. The button with the empty cycle should activate output 5 and turn on the yellow LED. Okay, so now the full cycle. The green LED confirmed that output number 6 was also switched on. Another push of the buttons and the LEDs should be off. Okay, everything is functioning as intended. Finally, we'll go over to Partitions, Zones, and Outputs State tab. This is to check what the wireless device's signal levels are. In our case, all the devices are lying on the table side by side, so the signal level is at maximum. However, at the actual installation site, these figures may be lower. You should remember that if the indicated signal level of any device is less than 40%, it is necessary to change its location. Sometimes, a shift of a few or a dozen centimeters can bring significant improvements. This is the end of our meeting today. If it turns out that any more issues related to PERFECTA control panels, and in particular the PERFECTA 64M model, need to be discussed in detail, please contact us. Thank you, and enjoy future episodes of the eAcademy. See you then!